what the grumpy man is trying to look. Okay, so let's start again with the choice of a kernel when you are building a new product.
Hello. So I decided to share some of my difficulties each time we have to ship a new product or a new version of a product, which is what kernel to pick for this product. And I think I'm not the only one in this room with the same problem. So this presentation will be for mostly for people who don't run their distro's kernel, for people who build their own distro or who have a good reason for picking or modifying the kernel or whatever. We'll see how you will have to identify your needs, what not to do, which is more important than what to do. The remaining options for you once you have eliminated the other ones, and how you can improve your situation. A bit of background first. I did my first kernel patch in 1985. I realized while writing it that it was 20 years ago already. That may explain the loss of hair and why people call me the old one. I've been maintaining very old kernels for a long time, 2.4, 2.6.32. In my previous activity, I used to ship some remotely managed gateways for customers. So basically, you put a firewall, proxy, whatever, remotely, and you manage it remotely. And more recently, we built load balancers, which use HAProxy, Linux, and a number of other components. And these ones are products for customers which don't want to know how it runs. The main challenge we are facing in such products is to maintain the system up to date regarding the bugs and vulnerabilities when there are vulnerabilities. In the gateways, in the remotely managed gateways, you can't count on anyone on site to assist you if you break something. So you have to be extremely careful, otherwise it's not fun. For the load balancers, it's different. It's just a product that you ship to a customer. The customer will have to upgrade sometimes. However, you don't want your product to break in the hands of the customer because it's not cool either. So, what do you need to update really in practice? I consider that on a system, there are just a few critical components. What I call a critical component, it's my definition, it's a component which is needed to fix a bug that you introduced by trying to fix it. You see, for example, if you break your kernel remotely, you will still need to have a kernel to access the machine again. So in practice, your mileage may vary, but in practice, the kernel, the libc, and the SSH are really critical components on a system, on a remotely managed system at least. Not all of them are really that critical. The libc rarely need to be upgraded because there are few bugs and most deployments don't really rely on it that much. SSHD is rarely a problem because most products do not depend functionally on SSHD, so you can pick the last one and that's fine. But the kernel is a completely different story. First, the kernel provides the drivers for your devices, your peripherals, or whatever. So you want to be sure that your product will continue to work after an upgrade. That's critical for your product. It also provides drivers for devices which are not part of your product, and sometimes you don't even know they are supported. For example, if your product has some USB ports, maybe you will discover by accident that if you plug a USB to serial adapter, it will automatically create a serial port on the system and maybe even present a login console or whatever. So sometimes it can cause some trouble and you probably want to be very careful about the extra drivers that are added with your kernel, and you would have preferred not to see in the product. It provides the various network protocols, the ones you need, the ones you don't need. For example, sometimes on a server, you just run LSMod, you see a rows AX25 and things like this, and you say, oh, someone started to run a rootkit here. So maybe it's just an undesired effect, and you would have preferred to avoid such components in the first place. So even if you don't use such features, having them in your kernel can be a concern and can require an upgrade just to avoid someone getting root, for example. And in general, the kernel provides all the security layers. If you have end-user access on the system, you need to maintain a certain level of security, and for this reason, you need to keep the kernel up to date. Due to all the things that the kernel does, it suffers a lot more bugs than any other components. And there is nothing wrong with this. It's a complex component, and due to this, it will have many more bugs. So I consider that the system is really sensitive. If you don't perform an upgrade, you can have various types of problems in field, such as the system which hangs once in a while, kernel panic, whatever, some data corruption or data loss, for example, if you have a bug in a file system driver or disk driver. You can face local or remote DOS. Same, it's just a bug that was not necessarily fixed. Someone getting root locally. Overall, what it ends up is customers which are angry at your products because they consider that you are not doing your job. Because if they buy your product, they trust you, and they trust your skills to maintain this product in a good state. The kernel is really too sensitive. If you fail an upgrade, in the example of the remotely managed gateways, generally, you have to take your car, a laptop, and a serial adapter, for example. For the load balancers, the customer considers that you are completely unable to do some serious work, and they will think that you are beginners. So you are facing a problem. Should you upgrade or not? If you don't upgrade, you risk local bugs which are visible to the customer. If you upgrade, you risk to break things, and the customer will complain that you did not need to upgrade because everything was working fine. So people generally think that you just have to run tests in your lab before shipping. That's fine. That's a good principle. But in practice, look, the kernel right now is around 20 million lines of code. The latest version alone added 1 million lines. It's 5%. Nobody can verify there is no regression in 1 million lines of code. And this is every two to three months, you see. So it's not possible to validate there is no regression. At best, what you know is that there will be regressions. There are new bugs, there are new security issues, there are new whatever you want, which are introduced with every single new kernel version. And again, there is nothing wrong with this. We just have to live with it. That's all. But you don't want to see these bugs in your products. So that's another problem. Just to give you an example with some numbers. Kernel 2.6.32 was released on December 2009. Greg maintained it for 2 years and a half. Does anybody have any idea of the number of patches which were merged during this time frame? 600? 1,000?
Auction?
Auction, yes. No? Okay. 3,300 patches. Okay? And you know, Greg doesn't merge useless patches. So in practice, you have seen yesterday, huh? Does not apply, hop, reject. Okay? So in practice, 3,300 patches were required to get 2632 in the shape it was when Greg dropped it at the end of its life. Okay? At this time, I picked it because I was using it. And do you have any idea how many more patches were added since then? So, more than 3 years later? No. I'm a very slow maintainer. And lazy. Anyway, it proves one thing, is that at least when Greg dropped this kernel, even if you considered, okay, it's end of life, it's nice, all the bugs have been cleaned up, that's okay. No, because you see, there were at least 700 more bugs which had to be fixed. And the scariest thing is this. 3,000 fixes were dropped because I had no idea what to do with them. When you read the patch, you say, is it needed or not? I have no idea. So the principle is simple. Nobody complains, better drop it. I'm saying that the kernel is a living thing. In fact, I think that as long as we can observe it, we will discover more bugs. It's a bit scary to realize that 10 years, maybe 20 years after a kernel is emitted, you still find new bugs in it. And you realize that during that whole time frame, the bugs were there. So maybe you lost some data, you had some outages or some intrusions or whatever because of these bugs, which were discovered very late in the process. So what can we do about this? You just have to ask yourself some questions. The first one, you want to put a kernel in your product. How long the product will live? It's not the same if the product will live 3 months or 10 years. So you have different choices. What initial level of stability is expected? For example, sometimes some customers will ask you and insist to have a shiny new feature, which you consider is not very stable, but the customer will say, hey, I don't mind, I want it. Okay, so the customer is willing to accept outages. So in this case, you can maybe take some risks to put something which is not very safe. But in general, it's not the case. For example, if the drone over there has bugs in its kernel and when you have it 100 meters high, suddenly it hangs, I don't know how it behaves, but maybe it will be in several parts on the ground. I don't know. Another funny thing, will your system accept hardware extensions in field? By this, I mean you have some really closed products and completely open ones. For example, in our appliances, our load balancers, we ship the network cards with them. And some customers say, hey, I have these network cards myself, I want to plug mine. We say, no, we have not verified your cards. We don't know what firmware version you have or whatever. All we know is that they work fine with the ones we ship. Okay? If you accept much more hardware diversity, you are probably risking to face more bugs. So it's a choice. If you are shipping just a regular server, you will have to accept hardware extensions. But if your product is really limited, there is no such problem. So that's something to consider as well when deciding about a kernel. Will you be able to update the kernel in field? That's another issue. In fact, it's not that much of an issue because if you can't update in field, in general, it means that the system has no communication with the outside. So sometimes you can take the risk of using a very old kernel and consider that you don't care about vulnerabilities. And if it has proven to work well for a long time, okay, it's stable enough, and maybe security is not an issue anymore. But sometimes it can be a concern. Another point is that customers also have their opinion on the kernel you are running. So sometimes they will not know what you are running, sometimes they will know. In our case, we used to ship 2.4 till 2011. Some customers started to laugh at us and they said, hey, are you aware that 2.6 has been out for, I don't remember, 8 years or something like this? And we used to say, yes, and it's not stable enough for us, that's all. But in the end, you don't look serious, so you need to upgrade or to do something. Maybe your customers will expect updates as well. Because even if you ship a kernel which seems realistically up to date, sometimes there is a vulnerability or something that everybody speaks about. For example, VM Splice a few years ago, everybody was talking about it. If your customer sees that you are running a kernel which is affected by VM Splice, he will want an update. And you can do whatever you want to say, but we don't care in this environment, it's not a problem because you are the only user, you are root, so you can get root more easily than running an exploit. But anyway, they don't want to hear this because they don't feel safe anymore. Can you afford downtime? Upgrading a kernel requires a reboot, generally. In some environment, it's not an option. So you have to consider this as well. Some customers maybe will only accept to reboot a system once every 6 months. So you have to compose with this during the choice. Just because you want to target the correct window for the update and try to maximize the stability during that period. And after all, maybe your customer doesn't care about security issues and you just have to target the stability. For example, if you are building, a slot machine for a casino, there is no connectivity on it, just a lever to trigger. Maybe they don't care at all about security, they just want something which does not hang while customers are playing. So that's another question to consider. With all that in mind, the first and most important thing is to ensure stability and to stick to what works. So if you have a kernel which runs fine on your product, you don't necessarily want to break everything and say, oh, okay, I was running a 2.4, let's switch to 4.1 and consider it will certainly work. No, it does not work this way, so it's important to not to break the product in the middle of the life cycle. If you you stick to an old kernel or whatever, you will need to backport some fixes, but backport only the fixes you need. If you don't know what you are doing, don't say, oh, there may be a problem with this. It will look cleaner with the fix applied. Maybe the fix will break something. So just backport what you need. And that's why there are stable kernels. But it's not that easy. Greg has shown quickly how the kernel is maintained. So just to complement a bit what Greg said, first all the fixes are merged into mainline and then only backported to stable. Stable lasts 2 to 3 months plus 2 extra years for LTS versions. The simplest bugs, the typos, the syncos, whatever, are generally found very quickly. So a small bug is introduced into mainline. Okay, you release 3.4, for example, with a small bug. 2 weeks later, someone says, hey, look, this was crap, here's the fix. And maybe 1 to 2 weeks later, the fix is in stable. So in practice, all the small bugs will be fixed in stable. The more subtle bugs can take several weeks, several months, or even several years to be detected. That means one thing, the more subtle bugs will not be fixed in a regular stable version. They will only be fixed in LTS. unless you are very lucky, of course. That's also why there are LTS versions. LTS versions are really much more stable than the other ones. And all the architectural shortcomings will never be fixed in a stable or LTS kernel. If your product has a limited performance because interrupts are delivered to a single core of the CPU, for example, and you say, oh, they changed this later, let's wait for the backport. No, you will never have a backport. You will have to upgrade to another branch. First thing is that end-of-life kernels contain a lot more subtle bugs that are hard to detect, much more than the LTS versions. Because, as I said, the simplest bugs are found quickly, so they have their chance to be fixed and stable. And the more subtle bugs take more time to be detected, so they have less chance and will only be in LTS. So when a stable kernel, a regular stable kernel, is dropped, for example, 4.0, which was... yes, you dropped it? Okay. So right now, nobody should be using 4.0 anymore, okay? Because otherwise, it contains many ugly bugs, and just the small ones were fixed. So probably you don't believe me. Let's see an example. 3.2 was released on January 2012. 2 months and a half later, 3.3 was released. By then, 3.2.12 was released with the same fixes. So the bugs which were fixed between 3.2 and 3.3 were already present in 3.2.12. 3.3 was maintained till 1st of June, and it was a 3.3.8, the latest 3.3 version. 3.2 was picked by Bennett Ching as an LTS kernel, so he continued to maintain it. At this time, we were at 3.2.19 when 3.3.8 was released, with the same fixes. More or less, okay. Right now, we are at 3.2.71 with 5,000 more fixes, okay? What this means is that if you are running 3.3.8, you have at least all of these 5,000 bugs, okay? That's something important to consider. And there are devices right now which are still shipped with this kernel because it was used by OpenWRT. You have it on a small 3G routers that cost less than $20, for example. You find it, you boot them, you SSH into them, you name minus A, and you see 3.3.8. So you have all these bugs in these devices.
I think that explains what you told us. They were trying to be building it at some point, so they choose the kernel. They need to be maybe the next level, and once they enter one version, switching to another version is taking more risk on breaking something.
So yes. Exactly. But it would have been a better option to stick to an LTS kernel then.
But that's why we have the same issue to choose because 3.2 was announced.
I remember we discussed this.
Yeah. And we were in the situation
But okay, but then if it's just a matter of being a cheap device, they should at least put a sticker on it, warning, do not use for anything serious. I mean, it's a Wi-Fi router. Some people will run their access point on it and will have I don't know how many people connected to their local network without even being aware of it.
Hmm?
And some people could think, maybe we should pick all those patches from 3.2 and apply them on 3.3. Could be an option. It would be easy. But it does not work. Look, what happened here? New bugs were introduced between 3.2 and 3.3. These ones will not be backported to 3.2 because they don't affect 3.2. Okay? And you don't know which ones they are. In practice, you could pick them from 3.4, which is LTS as well, if you know which ones they are. But it's a tough job.
Hmm?
Yes, it was necessary, because the bugs which were introduced between 3.2 and 3.3, which were not fixed in, till 3.3.8, will be there forever.
Or more likely, you can have patches that doesn't apply because the API changed, but the bug is still in because...
Yes, sometimes. But François, it's not even about the API, but look, a new feature is introduced in 3.3. I don't know which one. Let's invent a new file system driver, for example. You have it in 3.3. It did not exist in 3.2. Okay? It comes with bugs. Okay? You backport whatever you can. You forward port, in fact, from 3.2 to 3.3 to try to stay up to date. This one did not exist in 3.2, so you will not have its patch in the 3.2.3. So you will still have the bugs affecting this device in your 3.3 tree. That's the part I try to explain, but I agree. Maybe it's not very understandable. Okay. So keep this in mind. Okay. Never ever used an end-of-life kernel. Never. For no reason. And if you think you still need to do this, that makes Greg happy. If you think you really need to do this because, I don't know, you wrote a driver that cannot be ported or whatever, you have some hardware with closed source driver which only supports this version or whatever, You need to do your best, either to fix the problem and the root cause, for example, closed source driver or driver which is compatible with an old API that you need to port. Or if you don't have this possibility, then you need to try to help with version maintenance so that the version you are using is still maintained. It can be by asking Greg, please, Greg, please make this one LTS. It will help me. I don't know if that works. Or maybe you can join with other people who depend on the same hardware and same software and are willing to join efforts. I don't know, but definitely this is important. Then what should you do? The first thing is to pick a kernel which lasts at least as long as your product's life. In fact, even longer, because you don't necessarily want to run with too much bogus code at the beginning. It depends on the first level of quality expected by the customer. And you want to be sure that if customers tell you, my projects are slowing down a little bit, I can't replace the products right now, I want more support, maybe you will have to maintain it a bit longer. So it's important to pick the right kernel, and for most products, it will mean an LTS kernel only. The degree of confidence of the kernel you are shipping must match your customers' expectations. You don't have the same expectations for an ADSL router, file server, load balancer, a power plant controller, or even the Mars orbiter, which detected water on Mars, for example. I don't know when it was launched, maybe 10 years ago, I have no idea, but you don't need the same level of stability. So there's no point, for example, in trying to maintain 2.4 right now just for an ADSL router. It does not make really sense. If it crashes once in a while, maybe you don't care and the customer will reboot it and will not even report it. You will have to backport the missing features, maybe, because in the example I gave about 3.3 versus 3.2, if you absolutely need a feature which is in 3.3, maybe in the end it's easier to backport the feature into 3.2 and use 3.2 with a few patches to bring that feature, than using a 3.3 and leaving the nightmare of trying to find all the fixes. This is an internal choice that should be made. Sometimes it can come with some important costs. And there is a trap here, which is that if you only follow your current kernel's updates, you may miss the updates from the features that you backported. And do not backport infrastructure changes. It's the best way to shoot yourself in the foot. So sometimes you will say, oh, this thing is really cool. I don't know, maybe the clock framework completely changed or whatever. And you say, oh, it's nice to have it in an older kernel and you will backport it. And sometimes things will break because the subsystem will have been designed with the most recent kernel's assumption. And maybe some locking will be missing or whatever. It may seem to work initially, and over the long term, you may get burned. It's important to consider that you are not alone in your corner with your problem. In fact, everyone who ships a product is facing the same problem, and distribution vendors have the same problem as well. So it's important to discuss about these problems openly. If your distribution kernel satisfies, matches your needs, and provides everything you need, then use it. I mean, 3.2 is maintained for 4 years, I believe. Okay. Yes, I think that's it. It was released in 2012, and it's maintained till 2016. So it's twice the lifetime of a regular LTS kernel. If it works, it's probably the best option. It comes with the least work. Otherwise, try to participate and join forces to maintain your kernel. Discuss about it around you, and you will meet people who want to do the same thing, maybe with a slightly more recent kernel, slightly older, and with agreement, you can find a solution and say, okay, we work together and we co-maintain this kernel. But please, and Greg already told this yesterday, we have enough LTS versions right now. The problem is that there are many skilled people who are doing a great job at this, but for all of them, with their respective kernels, it's a lot of efforts. And these efforts would be better spent, in my opinion, focusing on less versions with more tests on a smaller set of versions than doing the job in parallel for every version. How can you participate? First, I'm not the first one to tell this, but you need to upstream your fixes and your improvement. That's not new. And nature crap, of course. We do all have local crap, okay? There's nothing wrong with this. I don't know how many crappy patches we have in our kernels. There are some that I tried to submit once, okay? Not accepted, not surprised. Or if you try a surprise effect second time, no, okay. Sometimes, yes. But contributing to the kernel is not only getting others to do your job. So if they consider that your work has no place in the mainline kernel, it means it's your job to maintain it. But fixes or improvements that can benefit to everyone are better placed in the kernel. Test stable kernels and report their status. It can be just a build test, but now it's properly covered. Booting it on your system, it's useful, in fact. First, because for yourself, you will discover some features, some breakage. For example, my netbook didn't like some changes in the 3. I don't remember which version 3. The frame buffer stopped working, and after that, it used to hang once in a while. Well, there was no emergency for me to upgrade, so I had the time to troubleshoot it once in a while. So it's useful to report a breakage anyway. And read the change logs. It's nice, and there is something I really like in stable kernels. I hate merges because I want to see a linear change log, and we have linear change logs in the stable kernels. It's not the case for mainline. If you want to follow progress to see what's new in a kernel, since every new feature comes with bugs, just by reading the stable kernel change log, you will discover the new features because you will see the fixes related to these features. That lets you keep up to date with the activity of the kernel without having to track a too complicated kernel, too heavy or something which you can't even read on screen. Even the short log sometimes is not readable anymore. And of course, if you see that some fixes are wrong, report them. Sometimes a fix has no place in a stable tree. Sometimes it will miss another patch, so it's useful to report this. If you are working on a stable version yourself because you have no other option, don't do it in your corner, communicate about it. You maintain it, you publish it so that people see your work and the errors you are making. Advertise it so that there is no doubt that this is for everyone and not just for you. It's the best way to have some feedback. As much as possible, don't maintain your own kernel. Out of three patches are a real pain. You need to rebase regularly. Sometimes you are in a hurry. There is a fix that needs to be pushed very quickly. And you discover that your patches don't apply on the latest fix, so you lose a lot of time. Sometimes you fix rejects the wrong way, so it's not a good idea, but anyway, we are still forced, all of us, to do this. Just a little bit of experience with the local fixes. 10 years ago, just before Git appeared, I had my local patch set for 2.4, and I was collecting some fixes, so I was keeping them in my tree. And 2.4 was maintained, I would say, the old way. So between consecutive versions, there could be a lot of breakage, and fixes for one version did not apply on the next one. So it became really painful. And I met some people who had the same problem and were complaining about the ability to maintain patches out of three, to maintain a 2.4 in a good shape, I would say. We all had the same problem, and I decided to publish my own fixes under a tree which was called the hotfix tree. It was a collection of fixes for various 2.4 kernels. And in the end, many of them were adopted by Marcelo, who was the maintainer by then, because I tried to submit some of them. Some of them were not good, some of them were okay, so he merged them. And for the other ones, I started to experience something I didn't expect. People noticed this tree because Marcelo advertised it in his commit sometime. He said, I picked some fixes from a released fix tree. People started to come to my tree to spot bugs in my fixes, to propose some extra fixes which needed to be there. And in the end, I was able to get a better kernel just for my usage. And these people were fine as well. The fixes got better, and in the end, all of them got merged into the regular 2.4. So just by advertising and publishing your work and your local fixes, you have a good chance of getting your fixes merged ultimately. I tend to consider it was the first stable with some code tree without this name. It was not called like this. It was 1 month before Greg started the stable tree. And in fact, it did not work the same way because we were completely the opposite way. The fixes went into the hotfix tree first, and then they were ported to mainline. And right now, it's the opposite. And it's better right now. There is no risk of losing a fix.
There's a little addition on top, and we already said about that is we have a trigger to count, but the network driver was totally broken. And the gateway, we have to backport it from all the versions, which introduces a new feature which prevents the backport option. And then your spec, you're supposed to maintain your own patches. Luckily, to make it work.
Yeah.
Well, it would be useful for the others because we know the driver doesn't work properly. And so we are in a stuck situation where the stable tree can't get a fix while it's broken.
I see. That's why I'm saying that we all have local patches. We don't want to have them, but we have them anyway. But if there is a public Git tree with your fixes and you show it to everyone, chances are that some people will spot bugs in your backports. Maybe even the author of the initial patches you tried to backport.
And it's just a cherry pick of the original. It's just the same commit on top of it, but it's the fact that it brings one feature in addition to the work.
I see.
And they don't make it available as an official backport.
I had this problem in 2.4 because I was using a GFI64 patch to avoid a hang after 1 year and a half. And I had this problem because it caused some side effects as well. I see what you mean. Any illustration of what it feels like to maintain local patches? We've been shipping 2.4 in our products for a long time, till 2011 and end of support in 2013. So it's very recent. It was basically unbreakable, very stable, nothing to complain about, except that it became a bit painful to port to newer architectures. 64 bits didn't work very well. IPv6 was really limited. It was not supported in Netfilter, nor LVS, nor whatever. So we finally moved to 2627. And by 2.4, I think we had something like 250 to 300 patches. When we moved to 2627, I guess we got rid of about half of them. Later, 2632, we got some improvements, such as support for IPv6 for LVS, allowing us to get rid of more patches. Some had to be replaced. I don't remember, some hypervisor patches or whatever had to be just rebased or completely replaced. Interestingly, we met some bugs with some hypervisors, some bogus packets which were received or whatever. And we discovered that they were already fixed upstream. It's just that they were missed in the stable process. That's something which regularly happens, and again, it's normal. So if you see that something is missing, you have to just to ask for the backport. And more recently, last year, or 2 years ago, I don't remember, we moved to 3.10 and dropped a lot of patches. We met a single regression during the 3.10 time frame, which was caused by one of our patches, which didn't apply at the right place after we rebased on the latest 3.10 after an upgrade. Patch didn't notice that the context had slightly changed, and it had two options to put our patch below or after the before or after the if. It picked the wrong option, at least the wrong for us. But that's the only one. We have been pretty happy with 3.10 right now. And very recently, we decided to upgrade to 3.14, and we dropped more patches because we had some backports in 3.10 that we could get rid of in 3.14. I don't know how many we have right now, maybe 60 or something like this. So it's more or less five times less than in 2.4. And we have less bugs thanks to this. Yes? It depends. We have been doing this for some watchdogs, for example, because you have a new motherboard with a watchdog which is not supported. So you implement it quickly, very simply, because watchdogs are very easy to implement. And in practice, by the time you complete it and you finish your test, you realize it appears in mainline under a different name or as part of another one. Or so I don't. Maybe we submitted one. I don't remember exactly. But it's the type of area where the first one wins. You see, many people develop in parallel, and one gets adopted. But no, we try to limit the local support for new hardware. That's a good reason for upgrading, typically. In the end, it's less work for us to maintain local patches because for each new major release, we switch to a new kernel instead of spending maybe 3 to 6 months porting the patches. Now it's 2-3 weeks, maybe. So that's something important to consider. Right now, we have four types of stable kernels. The standard ones that Greg maintains. They started by 2.6.11. The official LTS version that Greg started with in 2.6.27. I noticed he did some attempts with 2.6.20, 2.6.22, and 25. You will see they are visible. I will see you. I will show you afterward. I participated myself. I tried also my skills at 2.6 on some of them, just for fun. Then the extended LTS kernels, which people pick after Greg dropped them. The first one, in fact, was Adrian Bunk for 2.6.16. It was replicated with a few other ones. The first real one was a 2.6.27, which I picked several years ago for maybe two more years. I don't remember exactly. 2.6.32 has lived 3 years, 3.5. 2.6.34 and 35, I don't remember exactly. 34, it was Paul Macawas who dropped it recently. 35 didn't live long. And 3.4 is interesting. It's Lee Zefan from Huawei. We picked it. I don't remember how long he will maintain it, but he's doing a good job on it. And distro maintainers are now working with the official kernel.org repository, which makes them easier to find. Ben Hutchings maintains 3.2, Jerry Slaby 3.12, and Sasha Levin 3.18. 3.2 is really, really good. I'm going to drop 2.6.32 in a very short time, and 3.2 is a very good option for upgrading if you are still on 2.6.32. So what you see is that you have a lot, yes, a lot of LTS branches. I have just looked a little bit at the site, but Greg will be able to speak better than me about it because I have never used it. Just looked at the site and that's all. So you have plenty of LTS versions to choose from. You see, 7 is plenty. It's another problem. Here's a URL to visit them. It's the table that Greg showed yesterday. So how to choose? They offer a lot of choice. Do they evolve at the same speed? Maybe you want something which is reasonably stable for your products. Are they all maintained the same way? Maybe some maintainers like me are lazy. Maybe other ones take their job more seriously. Okay, so we will verify. You have vertically the patch count, horizontally the date. This is only for 2.6 kernels. You're seeing, I don't know. Yes. No. Okay. Here, you see 2.6.16. It lasted a long time compared to the other ones. Here, 2.6.27, 32, still maintained, but not for long. And the other ones, I was not exactly sure about. Kernel 3 and 4 are much more regular. You see 3.0, 3.2, 3.4, 3.10, 3.12. You start to see that some curves are crossing. So it's the patch count and the date, okay? 3.4, 14, 18, and 4.1. From this, you already see that the distro kernels are merging more patches. I suspect that they are interested for their users in certain patches, which are maybe not relevant for everyone, I don't know. And now, if we look at the release count, the number of releases on the same branch, as you can see, Greg's kernel, which are the bold lines, are very regular. Okay? The other ones are different. 3.2 is releasing less often. And if you look, I'm going backwards. If you look, it contains more fixes. So they are doing less common patches with larger patch set each time. It's the same for 3.12 and 3.18. Maybe, I don't know, it's too early to say. Maybe it will follow the same direction. So Greg basically releases on average one version per week in each branch. That's what I observed. distro kernel, okay, that's what I said. More patches, but less, more spaced. But it's fine to look at numbers this way, but maybe your product is not using everything from a kernel. So better focus only on what you are using or what is important for you. In the case of our load balancers, we are mostly interested in a few subsystems. When I'm saying interesting, I mean the ones which can be critical for the product stability. So kernel, MMIPC, lib, net, drivers net, and Arch. Okay. You see the curves are not the same. We start with 2.6.27 and 2.6.32, and the other ones after that. The three and four does not yet appear here, but the kernel 3 look much more regular than the older ones, but the process is has become very regular now. But there is something which strikes in these curves. Look closer. Just 2632 and 310. As you can see, maybe you don't notice here, after 15 months, three quarters of the patches which will appear in the kernel life while Greg maintains it are already merged. That means that if you pick it after 1 year of LTS, it already has most of the fixes which you can expect during the LTS life. So that gives some insight. First, you want to limit your effort at maintaining your kernel or updating your products. If you pick two recent kernel, you know that it will experience a lot of fixes at the beginning. It will be more work. If you pick an older kernel, you have less risks of getting nasty bugs at the beginning, but you will have to maintain it further, maybe, because it risks to reach end of LTS. What we are seeing is that if you pick a kernel after 1 year of LTS, which is really 15 months in total, because Greg counts the year after the 2 to 3 months approximately, you still have 1 year of free maintenance by Greg, thank you Greg, for your product for free. So that's appealing, because if your product lives only 1 year, you pick the kernel 15 months after it has been shipped, you had the time to validate it, and you know your product will benefit from free upgrades for 1 year. In our case, our product lives with 3 years of support. So if we pick a kernel after 1 year, we still have 2 years of maintenance to do ourselves. In practice, I did something even worse in the past. So I will feel like I'm on a holiday if we stick to 2 years of extra work. And given that the quality has proven to be quite good with the 310, that's what we are trying to do right now. So to pick a kernel after the first year of LTS and use the first year for free and maintain the kernel ourselves the two next years. As we can see, 3.2 and 3.4 could have saved an extra year because they will live slightly longer, but we needed more recent features before upgrading to 3.10, so we decided on 3.10 by then. And now, for the next for the upcoming version, we are going to update to 3.14, and according to that rule, probably next year we will pick 4.1. Don't pick two old kernels. Wow, I'm late. don't pick two old kernels because it's really painful to start to backport fixes after 2 years. In fact, when I picked 2632, I would say that three quarters of the patches still applied. Right now, maybe 10%. So you have to apply everything by hand. Security fixes are very hard to backport, in fact. Sometimes you don't even understand what the issue is. You try to backport it, you don't even know how to test it. So you ask the reporter for some help, and he says, oh, but I don't have any more machine running that kernel. I can't help you. So in practice, in general, they are kind and helpful, but sometimes not. And it's normal. I mean, they are not our slaves. They are kind enough to report a bug. We won't harass them to have the fix in old kernels. In 2.4, there were bugs that we couldn't fix. They were replaced by documentation. So it's a good sign that at some point, things must end. Some developers are on... Yes, that's what I said. Okay. Another point also, when you provide a very old kernel, developers are not much willing to take a look at it. So it's important to, I mean, sometimes they are not interested and sometimes they don't remember. So even if they are interested, they don't remember and they can't be of any help. So that's another point against two old kernels. And something which I did not expect is that the number of regressions start to increase again after some time. And I did merge some regression in 2.6.32 a few times already, build regression almost every other release because they come by two, you see. First one, and people say, oh, it does not build anymore. Oh, okay, second one. I'm surprised because 68 was released and nobody complained, so maybe it's fine. But anyway, it's easy to mess up, and if people don't help much, you will backport bugs into your kernel, and you don't want to do that. So that's another reason to avoid the two old kernels. The distro kernels, in my opinion, are getting good. For example, what Bennett Chings is doing on 3.2 looks very good work, and he helps me a lot also on 2.6.32. But I think Greg will agree that Ben is doing a great job on 3.2. And I think that their kernel is of really, really good quality. And Jerry seems to be doing a very good job on 3.12 as well. Maybe there are more users, I don't know, in fact. Maybe, Greg, you have some numbers or some ideas between the number of users of distro kernels versus LTS. No, you don't know either. So... They are maintained for more time, which is quite appealing for some products. The people who are maintaining these kernels have really strong skills. And I notice this every time I produce a review of 2.6.32 because there are people who tell me, hey, don't backport this, it does this and that. I don't understand what they're saying, so I obey and that's all. But that proves that there are less risks in these areas than by doing the work yourself or just trusting a friend. Most of them, yes, are now, I said, SUSE, Oracle, and Debian are on kernel.org. So that's convenient. You don't have to guess that kernel exists somewhere and where the repository is. So... in my opinion, they can be a good choice when they are compatible with your product and your expectations. That's something which we'll have to judge over the long time. Right now, in my opinion, in my experience, it's too early to judge, but I think it's becoming good. The only regret I have regarding this is that, as I said, we are multiplying the efforts, and I'm hurry up. It's almost finished. I know. It would have been nice if they had picked Greg's kernels and maintained them for a few more years instead of multiplying the efforts. That you don't care. Ah, see, yes, one point. Avoid to hurry up your updates during July, August. That's the period where we get a lot of security reports. Sometimes they are wrong. Sometimes the fixes don't work very well. We have seen some, I would say, some either non-working fixes or wrong reports during that time frame. Observe a little bit. Almost no regression in the LTS and test. That's important. Okay. Always think about the next upgrade you will have to do. That's important. Someone said, it was Eric, who had fun about me because I'm running 4.1 on this laptop. Wow. It's not an accident. If we think that it can be the next kernel of choice for our products, I will have experienced it for 1 year. And if I see that it regularly crashes or whatever, we will say, maybe not this one. If it works well, why not? That's all. Almost in time. Quick question.
You are about to use the 2.6.32 maintenance because it's entering the AOL. Will you pick another one?
Oh, yes. I said, Greg, that I will pick a 3.10 when he drops it. Because anyway, and it will be the same for 3.14, likely. Because if we use them when there is only 1 more year of maintenance, when we use them in our products, we need someone to do this job. So If it's not too old, it's a fun task. If it's too old, it becomes really boring. Other question? Yes. In part, I would say. In fact, we discussed about the outcome of 2632, which was announced for end of life during this summer. He told me that he uses it in Debian till February 2016, I believe. So he was about to pick it, but he did not know really well, so I proposed to pick it. I repeated what I'm always saying, that it would be easier if if they would stick to the regular LTS kernels, but it's their choice. I mean, we cannot influence distro maintainers. If they realize that there is some benefit for them to pick a kernel which has already been maintained for free for 2 years, maybe it will help. I don't know. I agree. Sure, but outdated by 6 months for a distro which maintains it for 4 or 5 years, I'm not completely convinced. Okay, but when did they start to ship 3.16? Maybe when they started to ship, I really mean ship, maybe 3.18 was already available. Exactly. But you see, that's a trade-off.